Okay, this time we're going to solve an optimization constraint problem in continuous variables, and in this case is a minimization problem with two linear constraints, as you will see, that form a polytope, a regular polytope, as the 0, 0, 0 point, the origin of coordinates, is one of the vertexes, so it's a regular polytope, and the objective function is square, so basically it's an hypersphere, a little bit displaced. We are going to use the Rosen gradient projection technique to do that, and this technique what uses is a strategy called the active set strategy, in which at every point we are dividing our constraint set in two sets, one for the tight constraints and another for the loose constraints. So we will be doing this iteration by iteration. As I've said, I will start with the point x0 being 0, 0, 0, 0, because is one of the easiest points to work, and as I've said, is a vertex of this constraint, so is useful for that. Also useful to calculate the derivatives of the system. So another important thing is that in such a problem, we always want that the variables will be positive. So we add four constraints, g3, g4, g5, g6, just to ensure that the solution is positive in any case. And I put them with the negative signs just to follow the rule given by these inequalities, right? So in this type of problems, for a minimization problem, we always keep our inequalities less or equal. For a maximization problem could be reversed, but always with the same criteria. That is important. So we want that our variables would be positive. This is, if I multiply any by -1, is saying that x1, the inequality changes, would be greater or equal than 0. So it's the same of saying that, but just keeping the inequalities. We follow the gradient search. So the first thing we have to do is calculate the gradient of this function, that is the partial f over partial x1, partial f over partial x2, partial f over partial x3. So our gradient would be one thing. Before doing this, let's say another thing. As we are going to minimize, the gradient has two directions, one positive and one negative. As I'm going to minimize, I need to follow the negative direction on the gradient. Otherwise, I would be maximizing. So just as I want the negative direction, just let me do the derivation in reverse. So this would be 2 less 2x1 minus 2x2 minus 2x3 and 3 minus 2x4. Because I use this vector, this gradient vector, this negative gradient vector will be used along the iterations. And let me call it just D as a direction, D. And D would be at every time this vector. What we do, the first thing we have to do is substitute our starting point. If this is our starting point in this system, we need to do two things. One thing is calculating f in this point, what is easy, because as I've said, if you substitute 0 here, you obtain 0. So this is our first iteration is the value of the function. And the other thing we have to do is just calculate the minus gradient over this function point. So this is giving us 2, 0, 0, 3. Okay, this is the minus gradient. What we do here is now we need to descend. We want to descend. Just look for the constraints, which constraints are tight and which constraints are loose. In this point, all of this becomes zero, and zero is less than 7. And for the second constraint, the same. The only constraints that are tight are the non-negatives in this point. These 4 are tight, and these 2 are loose constraints at this point. So by this, I mean that we can use, as only the non-negative constraints are tight, we can descend over this function just using the direction given by the minus gradient. So in this first iteration, call it iteration number 0, I would use this vector of direction. I would follow this vector of direction, right? So like in a, it is like the steepest descent method when there are no constraints, but with some features that I'm going to explain. I will follow this, but also if I follow this as long as I can, what would happen is that in some point I would violate one of the constraints, and I need not to violate any of the constraints. To do that, what I need to do is calculate a little table that is, I put here the loose constraints. At this point, x0 was g1 and g2. And then what we do is just evaluating these constraints, minus g in this point, x0. And another thing we have to do is multiplying the loose constraint times our vector of direction, in this case is d, of the iteration 0. And then what we will do is just divide these terms by these terms. So let's begin by the numbers. G of x0 is substituting the point here and lessing 7, so it gives us minus 7, but minus minus 7 is giving us 7. The same for the second equation. If I substitute here x0 in the second equation, again, if this value is 0, 0, 0 less 6 is minus 6, and minus minus 6 is 6. So the value of the constraints is clear. The multiplication of the loose constraints, as I've said, are these two. 2, 1, 1, 4, and 1, 1, 2, 1. These are the loose constraints times our vector of direction, that is 2, 0, 0, 3. This is giving us 16 and 5. Okay. Then what we do is we need a positive lambda, and what we do, as I've said, is dividing this term over this term, 7 over 16 and 6 over 5. And for the positive, if there is any negative, it is discarded. For the positive, we take the minimum. The minimum over these two is this vector. So this lambda, that is a scalar, is the maximum length in which I can move following the direction of the gradient. If I will go farther than this point, what would happen is that I will be violating one or two or both constraints. So this is our maximum step length, just to not violate any of the constraints of the system. So with this in mind, I can calculate the new point, because this is an iterative method. The gradient projection method is an iterative method, and what we do at every is iterate. So the next point, x1, would be our first point, x0, plus this scalar that we have found, this lambda times the vector of direction that was the minus gradient. So just doing numbers, if the vector of direction was 2003 times 7 over 16 plus our starting point that was 000, this is giving us 14 over 16 is 7 over 8, 0, 0, and 21 over 16. This is our new point, x1. In this new point, we also do the same. We first want to evaluate what is the value of the function in this new point. And in this case is minus 3.199, more or less. I remember vaguely the numbers because it's a classical example. This, it is a good example. This, it comes from David Leuenberger, as I've said. The good thing about this problem is that as the objective function is in fact is an hypersphere, a little bit displaced, the gradient is basically pointing just to the minimum. So I hope that in few iterations we get the solution. So this is a good problem. It's not necessary doing iterations and iterations because these problems normally are solved in a computer, and the computer does thousands of iterations depending on the scale of the problem, right? So I say this because if you look at this point, we are closer to the minimum, but don't advance things. But what it is clear is that we have improved a lot. This is just because of this, because the gradient in a spheric function is just pointing to the minimum. So we started in zero and we have improved a lot, minus 3.2, right? Okay, and the other thing we have to do in this point is, let me see, we need to evaluate, of course, the new gradient of this point, dx1. So it's substituting this point over gradient function, and this is giving us 1 over 4, 0, 0, 3 over 8. Okay, right. Then at this point, we need to do, as is an active set strategy, as I've said, we need to know which constraints are tight and which constraints are loose in this point. So this is an important thing to do. Let me trespass the minus gradient over here. This is 1 over 4, 0, 0, 3 over 8. The objecting function is okay. The point is also okay. Okay. Let's clear everything just to make room for the next. And we are also in iteration number one. Then what we want to know in this point is knowing which constraints are tight and which constraints are loose. To do that, we need to multiply all the system, the whole matrix of the system, 1, 1, 2, 1, minus 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, minus 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, minus 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, minus 1. We multiply the whole matrix by the new point, that is 7 over 8, 0, 0, 21 over 16, and this is giving us 7, 35 over 16, minus 7 over 8, 0, 0, minus 21 over 16. What we are doing is substituting the point here. Substituting the point here is multiplying both matrices, and then I compare with the independent term. The independent term is 7, 6, and zeros, to see what constraints are loose and what constraints are tight. So the first constraint, number one, is tight. The second is loose. The third is loose. the fourth is tight, the fifth is tight, and the sixth is loose. With this in mind, I know that our tight matrix then is formed by following this rule that we have seen here. Our tight matrix is capital AT. Well, T naught could be mistaken by a transpose. Capital AT is first constraint to 1, 1, 4, and the number fourth, that was 0, minus 1, 0, 0, and the fifth, 0, 0, minus 1, 0. Okay, this is our active set, in fact, in this point. Then, an important thing to do is knowing if it is better descending using just the gradient, as we did in the first iteration. In the first iteration, we did that because this point was a vertex, but this vertex was pointing to the inner part of the polyhedra. But at this time, it's different because one of our constraints, G1, is being tight. So we need to know if it is better following the direction of the gradient, or we need to project the gradient onto the tight space. To know that, what we do is multiply the tight matrix times our derivative, 1, 4, the gradient at the first point, the value of the gradient at the first point. And if we do that, this is given 0, 0, and 2, if I'm not mistaken, and 2. So multiply a capital AT times D. And we look at the components of the vector. If all of the components were 0 or negative, we will continue descending using the gradient. But if one, just one component of this multiplication vector is positive, then this is telling us that we need to project the gradient onto the tight space. What is happening here is more or less something like this. It's not the same, it is just an example. I'm not following this geometry, but this is just an example. Imagine that these were our constraints, and we started in a point, in the 0, 0 point, and we follow simply the direction of our gradient till we touch this constraint, G1, for example. It's just an example. But once we have touched G1, if we want to continue descending, as one of the constraints is being touched, the only thing we can do is just projecting the gradient in the next iteration, projecting the gradient onto the tight space. Because if not, what would happen is that, for example, we could be trespassing our constraint and violating them. So as we cannot do that, the only way to do that is projecting this gradient onto this constraint, or the active set constraints, as happens here. So what I'm gonna do, to project the gradient, what we do is an operation. We look for a matrix that is called the projection matrix. Projection matrix is identity plus capital A tight primes plus capital A time tight times capital A tight prime inverse times capital A tight. So it's performing a multiplication. And you know the matrix that we get here was 2, 1, 1, 4, 0, minus 1, 0, 0, and 0, 0, minus 1, 0, because these were the tight constraints at this iteration. So just doing this operation, I let you as an exercise, this gives you a matrix of projection. In this case, this matrix of projection is giving us (4/5, 0, 0). I just give you the results. (-2/5, 0, 0, 0, 0). It's a 4×4 matrix, 0, 0, 0, 0. (-2/5, 0, 0, 1/5). This is the projection matrix. And then what we do is just calculating a new vector. I cannot call it D because D is just the pure gradient. What I'm gonna do is multiplying the gradient, the minus gradient, in the point x1. I'm gonna multiply this by the projection matrix, and this is gonna give me another vector of direction that is that projection that I mentioned in the other picture. And this vector, I'm gonna call it vector dir of the first iteration. This vector dir of direction, for example, is in this case, this is giving us 1/20, (0, 0, 0, 0, -1/40). This is our vector of direction. Once we get the vector of direction, there are an important thing to do. That is, I haven't talked yet about what is our optimality test, but now is the time of saying it. The optimality test is that we can stop whenever the norm of this vector, the norm of this vector, is less than or equal than a fixed number, small number, epsilon normally, that we set first before doing any calculation. I should have said, I beg your pardon. We fix a little and a small epsilon, and whenever this norm, the norm as you know is squaring all the elements, square of this plus square of this plus square of this plus square of this, and then taking the square root. When this is smaller than a fixed quantity, very tiny quantity, then we stop. But in this case, this is not the case, because if I'm not mistaken, this is given as 0.05 something, so still not reached the convergence. The next thing we would do, if as this is not accomplished, we will continue doing iterations. But when this happens, normally, if you see any program for the computer, what we do is normalize this vector. I'm not going to normalize the vector just to ease my personal calculations, but a good thing to do just to keep this vector small is to normalize dividing by the norm all of these components, but I'm not going to use it to do it, right? So I will keep with this vector. Okay, having said this, we have checked that the norm is not, we have not reached this little fixed quantity, and with this in mind, with this vector in mind, what we do again is calculating the maximum length allowed just to not violate any of these constraints. You remember the lambda. To calculate the lambda, we multiply, we are not using the the tight constraint, we are using the loose constraint. The loose matrix was capital A loose, was for the second 1, 1, 2, 1, -1, 0, 0, 0, and 0, 0, 0, -1. This was our loose matrix. Then what we do is multiplying the loose matrix by our vector of direction. Now it's projected. In the first iteration was the pure gradient, but now it has been projected, this vector of direction. And this multiplication gives us our desired column of this A times dir. The other thing we have to do is to evaluate the constraints on this point G of x1 for the second constraint, the third constraint, and the sixth constraint, that are the loose constraints. And then perform the division between all of these, just to find the lambda, the positive lambda minimum. I don't know what is the results of substituting the point. At the point, if you remember, x1 was 7 over 8, 0, 0, 21 over 16. What I need to do is to substitute this over here and see what are, the constraints, less in the right-hand sides of the equations. But seems to be 61 over 16, 7 over 8, and 21 over 16. And this multiplication is giving us 1 over 40, 1 over 40, minus 1 over 20, and let me see the other, 1 over 40. As I said, we do the division, but as I said, this is negative, it's discarded. So we divide this over this, and this over this, and this is giving us, see, 305 over 2, and 505 over 2. So clearly the minimum is 505 over 2. This would be our maximum length. Just to not violate any of the constraints. This means that our next point, x2, can be moving using the previous point, x1, plus this lambda, 105 over 2. This is the maximum length, following our vector of direction that has been projected. So to find the x2 point, what we do is multiplying 1 over 20, 0, 0, minus 1 over 40, times 105 over 2, and we add this to the previous point that was 7 over 8, 0, 0, 21 over 16. Plus, times, this is giving us our second point, x2. If I'm not mistaken, this gives us 7 over 2, 0, 0, 0. Our next point is giving us this result, and x2. And what, as always, what we do once we get x2 is calculating f of x2, going here, substituting the point. This is giving us 5.25. I'm just remembering the numbers. And also we need to calculate the pure gradient, the gradient, the minus gradient, because we are descending in this point. So we substitute this point over here and find the vector of direction, of descending direction. Just doing the numbers, substituting only 3.5 here, the rest are zeros. What we get is minus 5.003. This would be our vector of directions. And then we are going to do one thing that is new in these iterations. We have found the maximum length allowed just to not violating any of the constraints. I repeat this as a leitmotiv every time. But there is one thing that I haven't mentioned yet, that is, exists any other length, call it optimum length, between these two points? That is to say, how do I know that it does, how do I know that maybe, for example, call it this new parameter t, how do I know that it does not exist a better length in the sense of optimizing this function over our vector of direction that give us a better point than this one? At every iteration we need to look this, right? At every iteration we need to look this. This is the, we are in the first iteration, so it's time to look this when we have calculated just what it should be the next point. But before taking this next point as our true next point, what we need to do is to ask if there exists a better length, call it an optimal length better than this. We know that the maximum is this, right? The minimum of course would be zero, but how can we calculate this point? There are numerical ways of doing that. The most useful is the Armijo's rule, but there are others, the dichotomous search, I don't know, many. I'm gonna do it just in an analytical way. In an analytical way, what we do is this. What we ask is this. If I know that my x1 point is 7 over 8, 0, 0, and 21 over 16, I want to know if there exists another scalar, call it t, that multiply by our vector of direction, that was 1 over 20, 0, 0, minus 1 over 40, could give me a better performance than the x2 using the lambda. To do that, what I do is substituting this. This point is going to be substituted on f. So I calculate f of x1 plus t times the vector of direction. And then what I do is minimize this function just to see if this scalar appears, just to see if I find an optimum here. So doing that, I need to substitute over my function this, as x2 and x3 is 0, we only working with x1 and x4. So what I will be doing is 7 over 8 times t over 20 square plus 21 over 16 minus t over 40 square minus 2 times 7 over 8 plus t over 20 minus 3 times 21 over 16 minus t over 40. So we do computations, we develop these brackets, the squares, everything. This is giving us this. This is giving us 4t squared less 4t less a big numbers in this case, but don't worry too much. 4095 and divided over 1000 over 280. The important thing are the terms that contain t. I want to minimize this. To minimize this, what I do is, as you know, taking derivatives. So if I derive this, what I get is partial f over t equals to zero, just to find the critical point, is giving us 8t minus 4 equal to 0. So 2t minus 1 equal to 0, so t equal to 1/2. Okay. And if I derive again, I take a positive that ensures that t star is being a minimum. So we have found such a scalar. This is very important in this Rosen's gradient projection, but sometimes between the point and what we the next point, in this trajectory, we will find another point that is better, that is optimum in the sense that minimizes this function. And we have found it. So instead of working with the x2 that we found just was 7 over 2, 0, 0, 0, instead of working with this number that in fact give us poor results in terms of the objective function, but the objective function was 5.25, we are going to use this scalar to find a better point. Okay, clear things. So what I'm saying is that I'm gonna use our x1 point that was 7 over 8, 0, 0, 21 over 16, but now I will multiply it by 1 over 2, this t star, times our vector of direction that was over 20, 0, 0, minus 1 over 40. This was the 1. So if I do this operation, this is giving us our true our true, that would be 0.9001.3. This is giving us this. Again, at this point, we evaluate the function of this point. Let's call it different from the other. And this is giving us minus 3.2. And the derivative of this point, the vector of the descending vector using just the gradient, is giving us, substituting this point over here, 0.2000.4. Okay. At this point, we need also to know which constraints are tight and which constraints are loose. But whenever you find a point that is in the middle of the first x2 we obtained and the previous x1 that has been, it's like an interpolation, the space, the active set does not change. So I let you as an exercise just prove that if I substitute this point over the constraints, the same constraints are going to be tight and loose. So it's going to be tight the first constraint, and the fourth and the fifth, constraints are going to be tight and are going to be loose. No, I'm saying wrong. The tight constraints are 2, 1, 1, 4, the first, and if this point is 0, is minus 1, 0, 0, and 0, 0, minus 1, 0. So the tight constraint is 1, is the 4th and the 5th. It seems to be okay. It's the same as in the other, as in the previous iteration. These are the tight constraints. And the loose constraints would be the 2nd, the 3rd, and the 6th. That would be why this is important, just for one thing, because if the space is the same, has not changed, if the active set is the same, we know that for this point we have to project again the gradient onto the tight space, so the projection matrix will be the same. The projection matrix in our third iteration would be the projection matrix in the first iteration, that is to say, because the active set has not changed. This was 4 over 5, 0, 0, minus 2 over 5, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. It exists a symmetry here always, 0, 0, and minus 1 over 5. Our projection matrix is the same, right? So to find the vector of the new projected vector of this of descending, the dir 3, what we do is multiply the pure gradient, the descending gradient, but by the projection matrix. Okay. If I do that, what I obtain, and I'll let you as an exercise also, is 0, 0, 0, 0. So, first time match. Because as I said, the stopping rule was when we find that the vector of direction, its norm, is less or equal than a fixed epsilon, then we stop. Well, just multiplying, we get 0. So, it's better, it's the best. We have to stop here just to see if we have found something or not. This is just a necessary condition, but not sufficient. But it's a necessary condition that the norm of the vector of direction projected, or if the minima is interior, not projected, that would be the gradient only. If the norm is zero or very small number. So this happened here. Then the next thing we have to do is calculating the Kantaker multipliers or the Lagrange multipliers. The Lagrange multipliers for a problem of minimization, and every time that we have set the problem of minimization with all the constraints in the way of less or equal than, the Lagrange multipliers have to be positive for the tight constraints, of course, for the tight constraints. The tight constraints are 1, so U1, U4, and U5 have to be positive, all the three. And the loose constraints, its value is 0, so U2 equals 0, U3 equals 0, and U6 equals 0. These are the Lagrange multipliers. If this is true, if the multipliers of the tight constraints are positive, then this is a sufficient condition just to assure that we have reached the local minima, that as the problem is convex, would be the global minima. Just calculate it. We calculate using the formula in matrix. I would use a matrix equation. This is A tight times A tight prime inverse A tight times the vector of direction in the point x3 was the vector. This vector of direction was, if you remember, at this point, 0.90013 was 0.200004. Our matrix, we know what is our matrix, is 2, 1, 1, 4, 0, minus 1, 0, 0, and 0, 0, minus 1, 0. So just doing these multiplications, what we get is that this is giving us 0.1, or 1 over 10, if you want. 1 over 10, positive, 1 over 10, and 1 over 10. So, we have found, really, because now the Karus-Kantaker conditions are being accomplished. We got a vector of direction that is 0 in its norm, and we got positive multipliers. So, okay. What would happen if some of these multipliers were negative? Then what we do is returning to the projection matrix and subtracting the most negative, if there are many negatives, the most negative, if there is only one, we subtract these constraints and then recalculate again the projection matrix. This sometimes happens, that we get some negative. It means that we haven't reached the minimum, we have to continue our iterations until all of them become positive. But in this case we are lucky, because at the first calculation of the matrix of multipliers, all of them are positive. This means that we have the Karus-Kantaker conditions are being accomplished. This means that the vector of direction, but if you remember in our third iteration, that was the minus gradient of x3, this vector 0.200, 0.4 has to be equal to the Lagrange multiplier of the tight constraints. The first constraint was 2, 1, 1, 4, plus the second multiplier, the second tight constraint was 0, minus 1, 0, 0, plus the third Lagrange multiplier times the last tight constraint, that was 0, 0, minus 1, 0. So the point x3 being 0.90013 is the local minima, but as the problem is convex, it is our global minima, and the objective function is -3.2. And with this we have finished, and I hope you have enjoyed this explanation. Thank you all.